All right, let's look at this last example here for sig figs, and then we will talk about scientific notation. So in this example, we're going to be multiplying, so we're going to have to use our rules for multiplying. So it says calculate the volume of a book with the following dimensions, and it gives us the length, the width, and the height. So to find the volume, we're going to multiply length times width times height. So if you multiply those three numbers together, it gives you in your calculator a number that looks like this, 2293.149. That's a lot of sig figs. And if we look at our three numbers that we used, they all have three sig figs. So our answer can't have any more than three sig figs. Otherwise, it is more precise than the measurements that we started out with. And you can't have an answer that's more precise than the measurements you were using to get it. So we need to round this number to have three sig figs. And there are basically three ways that we can do it. To have three sig figs, we need one, two, three numbers. So we're gonna have to round this three down to a zero. So we could say that our volume is 2,290 centimeters cubed, or we could put it in scientific notation to make it have three sig figs, which would be 2.29 times 10 to the third centimeters cubed. So either of those answers would be correct. You can write it either way, but they have to have the correct number of sig figs. All right, so let's focus a little bit more on scientific notation. So when we're in chemistry, we're going to be using really, really big numbers and really, really small numbers. And we're going to have to utilize scientific notation to represent those numbers. We're going to be dealing with, you know, huge, huge numbers when we talk about how many atoms and how many molecules we have. And then we're also going to be dealing with very, very, very tiny numbers when we deal with maybe the mass of one atom or the mass of one molecule or something like that, where it's a very, very, very small number. And to make it easier to write those numbers, we're going to be using scientific notation. Now, just a quick review, when you have a number like 4.6 times 10 to the 23rd, which is how many carbon atoms are in the Hope Diamond, 4.6, we call that the coefficient, and 23 is the exponent. Now, we could write that number out with 4, 6, and 22 zeros, but it's going to be a lot more efficient to use scientific notation. So when you have a number that is greater than 1, like 800, you move the decimal to the left, you have a positive exponent of 10. When you have a number that's smaller than 1, you move the decimal to the right, you have an exponent that is negative. So if you have trouble with scientific notation, come in for tutorials. I'm going to go ahead and assume you know how to do it. You've done it in the past. Okay. When you're adding and subtracting scientific notation, really, we're going to be using your calculator, so you're not going to have to do it by hand like this says here, but you do have to pay attention to sig figs, and we're going to get to that when we do a lot more of our examples. But if you don't remember how to add or subtract numbers in scientific notation, the rules are here, and when you're multiplying, the rules are here. Okay. Let's talk about dimensional analysis. This is going to be a key tool in chemistry and also in physics when you get to physics next year. It is something that we're going to be using from now on. It is basically a way to work problems. It is a problem-solving method. And I understand that when we start and we're doing some easy dimensional analysis, you might be able to do that same calculation without using the setup that I'm going to show you, but we're practicing the method. And you have to use it because when we get to harder problems, when we get to something called stoichiometry, you are going to have to use this method because we're going to have bigger numbers and we're going to have things that you can't figure out in your head. So we're going to teach you how to do it with easy problems, and then when we get to the harder problems, you'll know the method of dimensional analysis. So the idea is converting units from one unit to another. And we're going to use something called conversion factors to do that. And a conversion factor is a ratio of equivalent values having different units. For example, we know that 1 dozen eggs equals 12 eggs. Those are equivalent values, right? They represent the same number of eggs, but they have different units. So we can show that as a conversion factor. And to write a conversion factor, we're basically going to make these equivalent values into a fraction, and we're going to be multiplying a whole bunch of fractions together. So we'll take our equivalent values, our 1 dozen eggs equals 12 eggs, and we're going to write it as a conversion factor. So we could say 1 dozen eggs over 12 eggs. That's a conversion factor. And if you think about it as a fraction, if the numerator and denominator equal the same thing, this whole thing equals 1. So when we're multiplying by conversion factors, we're really not changing the value. We're just changing the units that it's expressed in. You could also flip it over. So we could also write this conversion factor, 12 eggs over 1 dozen eggs. And the way you use the conversion factor is going to depend on the problem. You're going to have to decide which way it needs to be written based on the units that you have and the units that you're trying to get. So that's what dimensional analysis is based on. It's based on these conversion factors. And I'm going to work through an example with you that uses some conversion factors you might not be used to. So let's take a look. It says, in ancient Egypt, small distances were measured in Egyptian cubits. An Egyptian cubit was equal to 7 palms, and 1 palm was equal to 4 fingers. If 1 finger was equal to 18.75 millimeters, convert 6 Egyptian cubits to meters. Okay. Now, when you're doing dimensional analysis, the very first thing you want to figure out is, what is the number that I'm actually trying to convert? Because that's what you're going to start with. So when we read through our problem, it gives us a lot of information, but it's actually asking us to convert 6 Egyptian cubits to meters. So this is the number that we start with. These are the units we're trying to get. All the other information that's given are the conversion factors we're going to use to get there. So here's how you start dimensional analysis. You start with what you're given over 1. So we're going to start with 6 cubits over 1. We just want it to look like a fraction so that when we use our conversion factors, we're multiplying fractions. Okay, so you always start with what you're given over 1. That is the very first step in dimensional analysis. Now, we want to multiply by some conversion factor that's going to let us change the units. Okay, so what do we know about a cubit? Well, it says here an Egyptian cubit was equal to 7 palms. So we know that 1 cubit is equal to 7 palms. Okay, that's a conversion factor. And we wrote it this way because we want the cubits to cancel. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to change the units that this number is expressed in. So we want to cancel the cubits, and we're eventually going to get to meters. Okay, so we need another conversion factor. What do we know about palms? Well, 1 palm is equal to 4 fingers. So 4 fingers equals 1 palm. So our palms cancel. Okay. Now, what do we know about fingers? Well, 1 finger was equal to 18.75 millimeters. So that's another conversion factor. So now those cancel. And we're still trying to get to meters. Now we can, because we know that 1 meter is equal to 1,000 millimeters. Okay, so our millimeters cancel. And now we can do the math, and it's just a bunch of fractions. Okay, so when you're multiplying fractions, you multiply all the things on the top, and then you multiply all the things on the bottom, and then you divide. So when you put all of that into your calculator, your answer is going to be 3.15 meters. So in dimensional analysis, you want all the units to cancel except for the answer, the unit that you want your answer in. In this case, it was meters. So we wanted everything else in our problem to cancel. Now, we're going to be doing dimensional analysis forever. You're going to do it the rest of this year, you're going to do it all next year in physics. So it is something that we will practice over and over, and it's going to get easier the more you do it, and I promise you it's going to be a very worthwhile problem-solving technique. But if you're having trouble, you have to figure it out. It's something that you have to know how to do. So make sure you bring your notes to class. We will be practicing dimensional analysis, and we'll be using the metric conversions like what we did here, and using our sig fig rules and talking about measurements in chemistry. That's what we're going to be working on this week. So make sure you bring your notes to class about units. Make sure you have your calculator in class as well.